if you'd rather build on Obama's legacy or vote for a candidate who will do something different, and the results, Sagar, are surprising.
I bet. Team Rising is here. We're joined by Democratic strategist and council member at large of Montgomery County, Maryland, Will Jawando, and Patrice Onwuka. She's the senior policy analyst at the Independent Women's Forum. Welcome to you
Great
both.
To see you guys.
So
Happy
before
Friday.
We begin, we have a breaking new poll. Reuters Ipsos poll, national poll. Bernie Sanders is taking the lead in this particular poll. Bernie Sanders is 19%, Joe Biden 19%, Elizabeth Warren at 13%. Okay, so let's before we begin, let's give all the caveats. It's an outlier
poll.
Plus, I don't know what the margin of error is on that. If the control room could look that up and tell me in my ear. So we don't know what the margin of error is. It's an outlier poll. Warren's only at 13%. It doesn't match anything. Still, it's significant.
However,
Will, give us your reaction.
Well, look, I think it still has the same top three, right? Mm-hmm. So we have to see what the outlier is, the order. Who knows what the margin of error is? But I think it shows that, you know, that's a consistent top three. We've been talking about this week after week. I'm surprised seeing Warren at 13%.
Yeah, me too.
AOC bump for Bernie, we know that's been out there.
The heart attack bump.
Yeah, right.
Well, the control room just told us the margin of error is 3.6%, which is actually not that large. This is a pretty solid poll.
Decent poll we've done before.
And look, it is an outlier, but I will say in the last few weeks, we've consistently seen Bernie Sanders increasing his margins in early states and in national polling across the board. So it's not that outside of the trend of that we have, in fact, been seeing.
Well, and I think it's interesting to see Elizabeth Warren drop so consistently. I mean, I think we thought she was going to be the forerunner. The last time I was here a couple of weeks ago, it seemed like she was the one to beat go up against President Trump. And I think the pay for her Medicare for All plan and her, just generally her her plans have really hurt her, because I think she's been disingenuous about how you're going to pay for it.
You're
and
exactly
saying,
right.
Oh, it's just going to be the wealthy. At least Bernie Sanders has said, hey, listen, regular folks are going to be paying for this too. And I think the authenticity issue that she has and being disingenuous on her policies, it's hurting her.
That's a very good point.
I think it's a good point.
It kind of has gotten washed out of the news in the last 2 weeks. I mean, obviously, impeachment is kind of gobbling up everything. But, I mean, look. Outlier poll, all that regardless. What we can generally say is that Bernie has been trending up. Biden has been either holding or he's lost a little bit of ground. And that Warren has dropped a bit. We don't know how much that drop is. This seems, you know, I don't think it's that she's actually at 13%. Right. But, I mean, I think a lot of this does come down to media coverage, Will.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because Pete Buttigieg has basically, I mean, he's gobbled up so much of her media. Why do you think that is? We've been talking a lot about that.
Well, you know, I think there's this Goldilocks syndrome that's out there, like everything to everybody. I think the fact that he kind of framed the race, you know, I think it was on 60 Minutes where he said, look, it's me and her. And so ever since that point, he's kind of, which was kind of funny and speaks to, you know, how his opinion of
hubris.
Himself.
Right,
But, you know, I think it's more about Warren, less about Buttigieg, that she released the numbers, the way she delivered that. It's kind of a coming down to earth. No, we're not going to be able to do all these things. And is that a realistic plan? I think people are, and again, that's a point in time poll. So we don't know exactly if that's going to stick.
That's always the useful things about polls. It's about trends. It tells us a little bit about, like, tiny little snapshots about what's going on the ground. And with Warren in particular, it seems that the handling of the Medicare for All thing really did, I wouldn't say it doomed her, but it gave her far more critical coverage than she was used to.
And she needed it, because up until this point, I think people have been like, oh, Elizabeth Warren, she's the professor in the room. She's got the idea. She's got the plan. She's able to put some sort of meat on the bones of general socialist light policies. And so I think it actually has hurt her, because she's again, disingenuous.
But I think it punctured the veneer of authenticity.
Yeah.
It made her look kind of like a traditional politician. Well, that was the problem.
I might also say some of her past gaffes, particularly on her heritage, have certainly punctured
her
authenticity.
Of course, right. Basically, she started off with a deficit, and just didn't.
Well, I will say the Warren people, I think, are also a little happier about this, because if you're going to have this come out and have the little dip now, and then you have a month or so to, or or two to build back up before Iowa. I think this is the time to do it. It would have this would have hurt more if you're into January.
I just want to say, when Bernie Sanders had a dip in the polls, there were all these pieces. This is the end, and he should drop out. And there was a Politico piece that was like on the road with a campaign in despair or something like that. It wasn't quite a movie, something like that. Haven't seen those pieces yet. On Elizabeth Warren. Hashtag just saying. Another poll out there that was very interesting. I dug into this one yesterday. Mm-hmm. Fox News poll out of Nevada. Top line is interesting in and of itself. Has Biden at 24, Warren and Bernie tied at 18%. But what I actually thought was really interesting in this one, Will, is I went down into the crosstabs and some of the other questions that they asked, and they asked this question of Democratic primary voters: do they want to continue the Obama legacy tradition, or do they want something different? Right. Now, we know that President Obama is very popular among Democratic primary voters, but when they asked the question in that way, it was a perfectly split decision. 46% said, let's maintain the Obama legacy, and 46% said we want a different approach. And it was actually, I looked at the race and the gender and all that, it was fairly consistent across the board with that divide.
Yeah, and I think, and I was looking down to the age too, because one of the things you see with Biden's appeal is that the older base Democratic voters are with him, and I think that broke down similarly. I think it's reflective on the moment in time we're at. We have a president unhinged, in my opinion, right? Rolling back many things that people thought were sacrosanct, not sure about their place in the world. The populism that he came in on that is still present about inequality and income and wealth. And so I think people say, well, we might need something really different if we're going to counteract and change these trends. And so I think you're seeing that in younger people. I think it's the appeal of Warren and Sanders. Particularly with younger voters. And so I don't think it's a rebuke of President Obama. I think it's just more indicative of where we are right now.
No, I see. I do think it's a big rebuke of President Obama, which is that he came in on the greatest mandate of change in the history of this country and basically hired the exact same people, ran the country as generally like a neoliberal holding government for 8 years, and that led to the rise of Donald Trump. And people saw that even Trump comes in, you know, the biggest shaker, really. I mean, what? It's a true movement change in politics, Patrice, and still not that much changed, right? Like, Washington is a hard place to break, and that's what that 46% number is, and that's what it represents.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. The challenge for Obama is that he thought that by imposing greater government on people was going to be something that would be a winning strategy. And I honestly think that people saying, 46% of Democrats saying, yeah, we don't want to go back to that, it says a lot. And in the general poll, in the general election, let's say you have this disrupt the system once again versus what President Trump has, I think regular Americans will look and say, you know what, the Obama agenda of tax and spend and bigger government regulations actually hurt me. The Trump agenda of deregulation and tax cuts, but particularly deregulation has actually stimulated the economy in a greater way than the Obama economy ever did. And so, you know, I mean, I look at these polls and I say at the end of the day, Democrats don't know what they want, but the general populace, I think, will really recognize that we are better off now than we were before.
Yeah, well, I don't know that the data bears that out, because if you look at, you know, the people who are saying we need to move on from Obama, it's the young people who are supporting Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren, who are saying we need to go further than what we've been doing. And kind of to your point, Will, I think that the Trump election, in many ways, it's radicalized Democrats in different directions. You see people going way out here on Russiagate in that direction radically. You see people who are more open to these sort of universal programs like Bernie Sanders. But the bottom line is, it really broke open the idea that we have to stick with this neoliberal consensus, or that that's the only way that we can get elected, because that's what the Obama era represented. And meanwhile, we lost across the country, we lost the House, we lost the Senate, and ultimately lost the presidency. So it was this real reckoning of, wait a second, we've been accepting this like centrist triangulating approach because you told us this is what we have to do to win, and now we lost.
Well, just on the first point, I will address that. I think if you look at Virginia and Kentucky, the people who are going to get Medicaid expansion, who are still benefiting from Obamacare and are going to have health care and actually live and survive and children on their insurance, I think they would tell a different story about whether they're better off or not. But to your point, I think it's split, though. You know, if you look at, we've talked about this before, the freshman Democrats that came in, most of them were moderates. And so you have, having with a moderate message, you do have AOC, you do have others that got elected. So I think you have this kind of figuring it out moment. I agree with you, the base, the energy is with the throwing out the neoliberal kind of, let's get our own version of populism and progressivism. But there is still this core in America where a lot of people got elected and they're trying to figure out, well, where am I and what do I do? And,
yeah,
and I don't know if that's been answered.
But they're not doing anything, and that's the main thing. I mean, they got to Washington and nothing happened, right? I mean, it's been two years
the
since they got
that's
here.
Moscow Mitch.
It's not the Senate. It's passing very far left policies in the House
and
that have
doing
no
anything.
Chance
right.
of passing because they're not bipartisan. And I don't think that's a good way of governing.
Mitch McConnell wasn't going to, it doesn't matter.
Neither of them are going to do anything.
They're not
going to do
anything
if the reverse happens.
The one thing I will say about the moderates winning, part of that is also that's who the party continues to support and prop up and fund.
Think about who gets the money.
I agree with you.
All right, we got more topics we want to tackle. Stick with us.